Hello and welcome. Thank you for joining us today for a conversation with leaders from around the world to discuss digital transformation in governments. Special thanks to Concordia for hosting us here at their annual summit. We hope you'll post about this event on social media. You can follow along at Concordia Summit and use the hashtag Concordia19. So in recent years, governments have been increasingly leveraging best-in-class technology tools and practices and bringing in top talent as they execute their missions. All around the world, we are seeing an expansion of how tech has more traditionally been used to manage back-end systems and data to moving toward more service design approaches, where tech practices and tools can make it easier for the public to interface with the government for their everyday activities, to pay taxes, to get a driver's license, to report a pothole. Today, we're joined by an expert lineup of speakers who are all part of that tech and government ecosystem. I'll briefly introduce each speaker before we get our strategic dialogue underway. This impressive group all bring a special set of expertise working around government digital services in a variety of ways. So first, our speakers who are currently serving in government. Daniel Abadi, the Undersecretary of Digital Government in Argentina. David Holmes, the Director of Engineering for the United States Digital Service. Philip Thigo, the Data and Innovation Lead in the Office of the Deputy President of Kenya. And we also have some speakers who formerly served in government roles. Governor Bill Weld, the former governor of Massachusetts. Megan Smith, the former US Chief Technology Officer. And some speakers who come from the multilateral and social support sectors. Dr. Mukisa Kitui, the Secretary General of the United Nations Conference on Trade and Development. Dr. Zia Khan, Vice President for the Rockefeller Foundation. Kate Wilson, the CEO of the Digital Impact Alliance at the United Nations Foundation, and Dr. Olga Hein from the Tel Aviv Foundation. We also have some speakers from the corporate sector, including Enrique Ostale, the Executive Vice President and Regional Chief Executive Officer for the UK, Latin America, and Africa at Walmart International. Kathy Conrad, the Director of Digital Government for Accenture's US federal government practice. Kathy also served in government at the US General Services Administration, leading tech work there. Then we have startup founders Jocelyn Boudet, the founder and CEO of Telepathy Labs, an AI company that uses natural language processing to help turn communications into action, and Mark Shmulevich, the Chief Operating Officer of Tiger, an AI software company that develops products for governments. Mark also has past experience working in tech in government for the government of Russia. And finally, we have leaders in academia. David Eves, who is the faculty director of Digital HKS at the Harvard Kennedy School. He also lectures in public policy at Harvard. And then myself, representing Georgetown University, which has a growing tech and society initiative spanning 9 centers across campus, including the Beck Center for Social Impact and Innovation, where my project, the Digital Service Collaborative, a project in partnership with the Rockefeller Foundation, where it works to support government digital transformation efforts. So, as you can see, we have an incredible group of colleagues gathered here today. Thank you for joining us. Thank you for being here. We're going to make the most of our time together with a conversation that I'll be moderating. I'm going to start us off with a round of questions and ask each speaker to respond with just 2 or 3 quick minutes and give everyone a chance to chime in. Then we will open it up for the strategic dialogue, and it'll be a great free-for-all. So our topic today is about digital transformation in governments, and specifically how governments are working to serve all people. So first, let's hear from all of our speakers about something you're excited about, that you're working on, that is part of your place in this ecosystem that's going well. And so again, I'll ask each speaker individually to give a few minutes on that, and then we'll keep the conversation moving. So Daniel, I'd like to start with you. You currently lead digital efforts for the country of Argentina. Your background was leading digital efforts in the city of Buenos Aires, so you've seen this work in a variety of ways. What's a project or policy initiative that you're excited about that you have been leading?
Thank you, Corey. Hi, all. Why a developing country needs to set up a digital government unit? I mean, a lot of need. We're a country with 35% of poverty, so why taking time to build a digital government unit? So for us, it's trying to, you know, reduce friction for citizens in their interaction with government. So what we did, we founded a startup inside government with this same challenges and limitations about, you know, gaining political power and doing things to gain that political power. And what we learned during this process, it's about, you know, it's about empathy. You know, we start looking projects about if it hurts to our citizens to do it or not. And that, you know, changed our idea of what services tackle first. The great example is, you know, when you live with a disability, you need to get a disability certificate in Argentina. And the process is extremely painful for our citizens. It's not a, you know, it's not a great moment of your life getting a certificate for you or for your child. And government used to make that so hard that people used to go at least 5 times to the offices to ask which papers, which documentation they need to take to them. So we start, you know, saying this hurts, it doesn't hurt, and start splitting that first. And for that, we create our online platform called My Argentina, which is a citizen portal where you can get a virtual assistant that gives you and walks you through the process to say, this is the documentation you need to take. But for building that, which is really small, we need to do, we got a blockbuster service like driving license, and we make it legal in our phone. So it, because it was so easy to explain to our citizens that now your driving license is in your phone, that gave us the power to go to more important things. And the other part was, we want to look for citizens that they are willing to have a service instead of waiting, sitting down so citizens come to us. That's a great failure in government. Government usually sits and waits citizens to come. What we did, we started working with pregnant women through a virtual assistant to encourage them to get more, you know, pregnancy controls, because that's extremely related to reduce the infant maternal mortality. So what we did, we created a virtual assistant that now works and helps women in Argentina to get more controls. And we are now building a scientific article where we have already demonstrated that 2 out of 3 women in Argentina during pregnancy, they use the assistant and they get more controls. And that is still, you know, it's working like a tool to reduce maternal and infant mortality in Argentina, which is really big. And for us, it's that, you know, it's creating a new experience for citizens with government and giving them services that are useful. That's what it is exciting.
Thank you. Let's move next to Governor Bill Weld. Governor, you led the state of Massachusetts in the 1990s. You also spent some time in the U.S. Department of Justice, so you've seen government from a couple of levels in the United States. You're also putting your hat in the ring to govern this country in a time where technology is a major driver for our economy and society. Is there an example of work you're tracking where tech is leading to more efficient and effective services for the public, or opportunities where that can take place?
Well, thank you, Corey. Thank you so much. It is true. I'm now trying to move to a third level of government, namely President of the United States. And there's a project I very much look forward to participating in as president, should I be so fortunate. And that's dealing with the impact of many technology movements, developments, AI, drones, robotics, machine learning, driverless vehicles, which are going to have a huge impact on employment in this country. Most people think that in the next 10 to 15 years, probably closer to 10, there's going to be an impact causing maybe 15% of the currently existing jobs in the United States to disappear because of technology. Now, I think that AI, in addition to the lead villain, is going to be the lead salvation here. It's going to make everything so much more efficient that it's going to create a huge amount of wealth, which not too many people understand. I went out, sat at the feet of the masters in Palo Alto and San Francisco a few weeks ago, and channeling that wealth, which at this point is nothing other than aggregate national wealth. We don't know what form and locus it's going to take, will be something for the federal government to think about very much, particularly with its social cohesion / income inequality hat on. And I do think that hat has to go on a little bit. So that's a huge, still amorphous task. I don't think it's yet being addressed in Washington, D.C. These displaced workers, you'd think of them as natural Trump voters, but I don't see Washington, D.C. really coming to grips with all the deep diving that has to be done. It's because they're too busy shooting at each other, I suppose, but that would be a great project. Moving just to a particular example, which comes from our number one, my campaign's number one digital guy in Washington State. He says that state has used digital transformation to dramatically reduce time and cost across a number of agencies, and I'll just tick them off. Liquor and Cannabis Board simplified their licensing procedure and reduced customer frustration. Department of Enterprise Services used it to identify problems in their inventory management system, resulting in a 70% reduction in the time required for the inventory process. Department of Enterprise Services Custodial Division improved safety, led to a 44% decrease in injuries. The State Patrol's Crime Lab has sharply cut the processing time for forensic DNA tests. Licensing cut the time handling requests for investigative records, cut it in half. Financial institutions cut the time to fulfill a public disclosure request by 75%. And lastly, the public disclosure team at the Washington State Department of Transportation's headquarters cut the average time to fulfill a records request by 54%. Those are statistics. As a former governor and potentially a future president, when I look at those statistics, I see time, and time means money. So this has a potentially significant budgetary impact, which is a good thing.
Thank you. Next, let's turn to Megan Smith. Megan, you were the third U.S. Chief Technology Officer. You served under President Barack Obama. You had that role for a little over 2 years. I was part of that team as a deputy CTO, so I would agree that our team got a lot done in that time. What are some of the policies or projects that you were most excited about then or now?
Thanks, Corey. There's so many things that we did that I think there's a central theme of it, which is there are people who have great technical skills. You know, let's take David, you know, the United States Digital Service teams, Philip, others. What we have to do if we want to have more digital government is have them come in the room. So we want to have incredible partners. Most of government will buy from the private sector, everything, right? But if you don't have someone in the room, for example, you're going to discuss something medical, we would like a surgeon general, so pull up a chair. A chief data scientist, pull up a chair. So you don't necessarily have to have all the doctors in the government, but you have to have at least one. And that's the same with tech, data science, technology, others. Of course, all governments have extraordinary technical people forever, like, for example, U.S. government, NASA, Department of Energy, and National Institute of Health. But really, if you think about something staying with health, Health and Human Services. Health and Human Services, if I, as U.S. CTO, went to the meeting on precision medicine, I would be highly expected. Right? Let's get down, get to work. If I went down the hall to human services and I went to the foster care meeting, before we got into government, we would have been very unexpected. People would be like, my computer's working. What are you guys doing here? And these genius people working with our foster care children who know what they're doing, you know, they have this dusty tech. And it's not fair. You know, we really know where every Amazon package is right now, and we don't know where every child on the border is. And that's outrageous, right? We're valuing these things. And so it's and the only way to do it is a very specific thing, which is the humans who build things like where the packages are need to actually work and rotate into the government for a little bit so the architecture right and the right people, and also our genius ethical humanities and sciences and others need to be at, I don't know if they're masters in Palo Alto, I think they got some ethical issues out there, but I think they need to rotate in with them because everybody's responsible for the AI work that's gonna happen in the future. So it's really, I call it TQ, in the room. And it could be for policy decision, tech quotient, like IQ, EQ, these things, in the room, all rooms, at least one person with other skills like management, et cetera. And we were able to do extraordinary things because of that. One of my favorites is the US Census. Census in most countries is the biggest big data thing. So we were able to offer opportunity.census.gov and get apps starting to be built on top of the unexpected agencies that had amazing data sets. We opened over 200,000 data sets. Kathy was part of that as policy work. And then now the data set dusty for certain topics. And there's an app for more and more restaurant deliveries, but not enough apps for the children who need free and reduced lunch. But we can do that. The technology is not exclusively for anything. It's whatever we imagine. So that's what we were able to do in government. And I think we brought over 500 Americans to government with President Obama, who had built Amazon, Facebook, Google, Twitter, Dropbox. And I know the Kenyans are doing this. Everybody's doing this all around the world. You know, you guys are an example of that. Pulled up a chair. And that was the key thing to do. And President Trump and others continue all around the world. It's one of the most exciting things that's happening, like you're talking Argentina. Thank you.
Thanks. A good segue to David Holmes, who's the Director of Engineering for the U.S. Digital Service. So as Megan mentioned, the USDS has now been around for about 5 years. It brings in top talent from the private sector to join with those in government service to do great work. David, you've mentioned you're spending a lot of time thinking about and working on security, naturally. Can you talk a little bit about what's going well there and what you might recommend, what you all have learned?
Yeah, so... For security, so a few years ago, we launched a program called Hack the Pentagon, right? And the Department of Defense said we couldn't call it Hack the Pentagon. They said, okay, cool, bug bounties exist. You can't call it Hack the Pentagon. So naturally, we just said, you know, we're a little bit of rebels. We're just going to call it Hack the Pentagon. And one of the coolest parts about that, though, is that bug bounties existed in private industry for three decades, right? Maybe showing my digital age here. But it existed since Netscape in the 1990s. And it just started existing in government just a few years ago. And since we've launched Hack the Pentagon, we've now done 16, 17 different bug bounty programs all throughout between Air Force and through the Marines. But that's just on our military, right? So how do we take those lessons and learnings that we've gotten through doing bug bounties within the Department of Defense and take that across other different federal government agencies, right? So how do we bring that to Health and Human Services? How do we bring that to the IRS? How do we bring that to the Veterans Affairs, right? And the way I look at it and the way I think about it is everybody who's in this country touches some type of federal system throughout their lifetime being here, right? So how do we make sure that data is secure for everybody? And the easiest way of doing that is by asking the private industry to come help us, right? Come try and hack our systems, right? But be responsible about it and report it. And right now there's no clear way to actually report, you know, vulnerabilities to the government without being feared of being prosecuted. So then before we even get to bug bounties and paying out, you know, to security researchers, let's even do something simpler. Let's just have vulnerability disclosure policies on every single website that allows people to report a vulnerability without fear of being, you know, arrested or the FBI coming in your house at 3 a.m. for, you know, trying to help keep America safe, right? So that's a big project I'm working on here. But I think there's other projects I'm really excited about here that we're doing at U.S. Digital Service. Like, as Megan mentioned, being in a room is important and is... And we can't just have all the top technical talent be in U.S. Digital Service or ATF or some of these top-tiered, you know, technical teams that we have in government. We need them to be at the agencies on the ground. So one thing we have is a hiring pilot. We're working with multiple agencies to figure out how do we hire those top technical talent into those specific agencies, right? Because right now, everybody who's at least filed on USA Jobs knows how difficult and how cumbersome that process can be, and sometimes it doesn't bring out the best, right? So how do we replicate private industry when it comes to hiring into government? Those are some couple of things I'm really excited about.
Thank you. Philip, you've been leading this work in Kenya for quite some time. You've been working a lot on open government, digital government, data, innovation. What's new and exciting there? What's something that's been working well for you all?
Thanks, Corey. I think the first piece I think is sort of the inspiration that came from Meg, from you, and that was important because then we knew we had friends out there who we could always say, but they are doing it, right? And so then we could actually take those leaps of faith and pull sort of the whole of government. And I think over time, including Rudy from Argentina, so I think for me it was that kind of natural ecosystem of champions. But I think for me, phase two, as I've been telling Meg and you, is that I think the most exciting thing for me is one is not necessarily the technology, because Africa has pockets of brilliance, but we need to bring everybody onto the table. And so I think for us has been to see how to how to use technology and services to improve what matters to citizens. And the work that we've been doing that is, besides other work, I think one is work around agriculture and food systems. Is how do we basically leverage on existing technology like satellites, earth observations data, and in situ observations to be able to provide data as simple as weather data to small, medium, to small scale farmers. So I think for us, we've been able to do this. And the good thing is that we are not only doing it for Kenya, which is important. We're actually doing it continent wide. And of course, with the support of NASA, the Group on Earth Observations, the Australians, so we've been able to put together about an $18 million package. And over time, we're rolling out sort of pieces around data, but also I think opportunities for innovators to be able to do the last mile connectivity. So it's something called, it's Digital Earth Africa. We are super excited. We are launching the first product, which is water observations from space. Continental wide, over 30 years of historical data, but also 5 years, updated every 5 days. For access for any African who can be able to access that. And over time, we are building that through. I think for me, that's something that I'm super excited. But I think for me, it's building from the sharing economy because no African owns a satellite, right? So it's basically how we've been able to leverage on the connections that we've made on the table over time. And the good thing is that even if I leave, it will live beyond me.
Thank you. Let's turn next to the multilateral sector. So, Dr. Kitui, your team just published a new report on the digital economy, and can you share a bit more about what you uncovered? What did you learn throughout that process? What did your team find?
Thank you. Just a summary, the most glaring statistics found that while the world has been consumed by the trade wars between the U.S. and China, U.S. and China are running away with the digital economy. 90% of the largest 70 digital platform companies by capitalization are American and Chinese. Over 75% of the blockchain patents in the world are U.S. and China. Over 75% of cloud computing market is U.S. and China. More than 50% of research inputs in Internet of Things is U.S. and China. So there's already a growth in geographical inequality, but also importantly, in consolidation and concentration between just a few giants. Google accounts for 90% of the global search market. And these are phenomena that just underlie discussions. As a commissioner of the Broadband Commission, I'm consumed by questions of how do we roll out broadband inclusion for the remaining 50% of the world population. But then we have also to look at how can we make sense for the included, who are mostly consumers but not content developers. That sustainable digital inclusion must address questions of turning consumers into creators, of capture of value. And this is one of the main things that we're arguing there. How can we grow governments to start taking up these questions of the monetization of our raw data, but the non-monetization of the benefits, the non-distribution of the benefits of such monetization. So the global debate has been reached by information that we are generating, and we're very excited about it. I'll leave a few copies of this report here before I leave.
Yeah. Wonderful, thank you. Let's just keep it coming around the horn here. So, Kate, we're gathered here in New York on the margins of the UN General Assembly. Top of mind in recent years for the UN has been the Sustainable Development Goals and how we'll achieve those 17 global goals over the 15-year period. The Digital Impact Alliance, part of the UN Foundation, has just come out with a great framework and has been tracking what governments are doing, what people are doing, to leverage tech and innovation to solve these global goals. What's exciting out there? What should we be all keeping an eye on and adapting where we are?
Well, actually, I want to take a step back and sort of ground it both in a story of human impact, but sort of like prior life, right? So before I ran Dial, my work was actually leading digital health solutions at a group called PATH. And one of the things that we did was we worked with 5 countries in Africa, 5 countries in Asia, support from the Rockefeller Foundation, to actually underneath an umbrella called the Joint Learning Network, which really focused on helping countries who were trying to achieve universal health coverage tackle what technology choices they had. It's because I think one of the things that we're sort of missing with all of this as we talk about digital transformation is everyone will tell you, go do digital, make your government digital. And then different pockets will say, here's the example of how it worked in country A or country B or country C. And we would do these site visits. And we would go to the site visit, and one minister turned to me and he said, I now see what we need. And I was like, what is that, minister? How will we actually help you with the platform? He's like, I need that. And he was pointing to scanners because he thought he needed scanners to scan his claim forms. The problem is not that people aren't sold on digital, and the problem isn't that the tech doesn't exist. The challenge is that we have not yet given a very clear roadmap of all the product choices that are out there and had enough of those people who can translate. And we should not ask a very talented minister of health or agriculture or education to become a tech expert. What they need is a clearer guide to be able to look at the technology that already exists and then be able to incorporate it and not have it go to waste as soon as the consultants who helped install it walk out the door. So working with the ITU over the last 3 years, this took a very long time. We said, instead of looking at e-health architectures and agricultural architectures in terms of platforms and systems or education, we were actually going to map where all those use cases were and how they intersected and try and illustrate to government policymakers who really need to understand this so that the Davids of the world and the Megans of the world get invited to the table at the beginning of the design, that they actually should be in the room because the tech isn't that different. Fundamentally, our phones, our laptops were not built for a sector. They were built to deliver platforms, and then on top of those platforms, applications are in place. And the data that runs from those is what they're really interested in and using those. And so it's so critical as you look at this to try and take a step back and take a look at all of those use cases. And this report that we put out, both as a call to action last year to help governments on their journey to digital transformation, and now most recently what those use cases are. And we've also launched a product registry beta, which we are looking at how we can actually then scrape all the data in the world around information, around potential systems that then could apply to those use cases. Not to pick a winner, simply to possibly be able to start to identify what would actually help you on your journey to scale.
Great. We'll keep an eye out for that registry. That'll be incredibly useful. Zia, the Rockefeller Foundation has committed to spending more than $40 million, I believe, to support digital efforts in and around governments by creating products and tools and services and supporting the teams, the people like us doing this work. Tell us about some of these exciting products that you all are investing in.
Sure. Thanks, Corey, and thanks, everyone. Really interesting comments. For us at the Rockefeller Foundation, what we're most interested in is how can we use our limited but flexible capital to spark innovation. And we want to try and lean into the innovation that's really hard to achieve. And where I see the opportunity, where we see the opportunity, is I think something that lots of people have been touching on, which is how do we integrate technology with government? And integration is a word that's used pretty casually, but I think it's actually very difficult to achieve. And it's more than the hackathon, it's more than having the conversations with the right people around the table. It's really about joint work that needs to happen together. And I'll just give an example of integration from our history. So in the 1930s, physics and chemistry had developed these really great analytical techniques. The life sciences had not. And so there was a lot of joint projects funded between physicists and biologists that led to the field of molecular biology. And we see us at the cusp, all of us, of a new field around digital governance. And how can we invest in and catalyze those integrations? And the word platforms has been used a lot. And I think that is actually the exciting opportunity, which are these platforms that themselves represent integration between technology and government that lead to positive outcomes that markets won't naturally lead to on their own, but on top of which new innovations can pile up. And so I'll give two examples of the kinds of platforms we're really excited about. So one is we're supporting a team in India, and India is at a very interesting inflection point where the growing middle class is putting more demands on government than the government has capacity to meet right now. So they have to be very efficient and very effective in how they use their resources. In the state of Bihar, we supported something which was, you know, fairly low tech, fairly straightforward, of a redress system. Kind of like in New York, we have a 311 number that anyone can call with a problem, and then it gets fixed. So you can imagine that a lot of, you know, the system's implemented, people are calling, government is responding, people have more confidence in government. Those are usually pretty predictable. The most interesting thing was that government workers themselves were using this number to call up and get their problem solved, and helped highlight to us around just the pride that government workers take in being able to solve problems for citizens, and how these platforms help that entire population, dignifying their work just as much as it makes a more user-centered service for the populations they're trying to serve. That's one example of a platform. Another example of a platform is we've invested in a company called Atlas AI that is taking satellite imagery, putting AI machine learning algorithms on top, and coming up with really precise maps in East Africa on crop yields, but also household consumption levels. And this kind of information is just not available to this level of detail and this level of accuracy. It is helping funding agencies think about how to plan their efforts. It's helping agencies that are implementing programs to monitor and adapt. It's giving insights to people to evaluate their efforts. And so we feel like this kind of information that we're pretty used to seeing in the private sector, to make it more available for these really complex problems, and we don't even know how people are going to innovate using these kinds of maps. But in a sense, these maps present an information platform that we're really optimistic that there'll be increasing innovation that'll catalyze it. So those are a couple of examples of what we're excited about.
Great, thank you. Hila, excuse me. Dr. Olga Hein is, Dr. Hila Oren, I'm so sorry, my notes are wrong here. Hila, your organization, the Tel Aviv Foundation, has supported smart cities in Tel Aviv and Yaffa. Smart cities are incredible. We're hearing a lot about them. We're all living in a smart city. What does that mean? And how have you actually improved lives for the people in Tel Aviv and in Yaffa? How have you supported that?
Referring to government digital transformation, I would like to put a focus on cities, because we call government, but actually by 2050, 75% of the world and the population is going to live in cities, and already we're there. So this is where we have to take and give the results to the challenges. In Tel Aviv, we actually understood that if we want to give better solutions, we have to listen to our residents. Now, what does this mean? How do you listen to your residents with this digital infrastructure? Because digitalization is, at the end of the day, only a tool. It's not a target. We have to use it somehow. So we formed a digitel, we call it, from the word Tel Aviv. We played on the digitel. Each citizen has its own digital card, and this way you're getting pushed by information into your smartphone. That means if something happens in your street, not all of the residents in Tel Aviv need to know about it, but only that specific resident. If you're an elderly and you need some specific help, you get some information. If you're very young and you need to register your kid, which is 3 years old, you get the specific information. Now, by having all that information getting pushed to you, it helps you, but it also helps us as a city to understand what are the needs. Now, this takes a high tolerance to privacy, because not everybody likes, and that is an issue of privacy when we're talking again about digital transformation. But I think we should wrap it up in I think one sentence: take off red tapes and put red carpets, because the problems all the time, and everybody's laughing, so I'm happy to, that means everybody around the table understands exactly what I'm talking about. All the time we just say, how come we can't do it, right? But we can. It's about us. It's about our leadership and finding the way how to get those solutions. So this is one thing. Another thing that I'm really passionate about is our city coin, but that I'll elaborate a little bit later.
Wonderful, thank you. I love that. Cut the red tape, roll out the red carpet. We should adopt that as our informal motto now that we have this club here. Okay, on to the corporate sector. Enrique, you're leading a lot of work for Walmart in a number of regions of the world. Walmart certainly knows its way around a customer-centric approach. So we're seeing governments move to more customer-facing services in a customer-centric approach. What can governments learn from leaders in the private sector, like what you all have done at Walmart and anywhere else?
So good afternoon, and thank you for the invitation. And as you said, I think we share a purpose. As we are customer-centric, governments are citizen-centric, as they should be. And tech-enabled, you were talking about the tools, and we have similar purpose. And because of that, we think first of all, the collaboration is key. And we were talking about innovations and how difficult is the innovation, and companies are innovating, governments are not trying to innovate. And there is room there for sharing, because as we said, we share purpose and we share technologies and we share tools, and we can cooperate. And at least in Walmart, we are a strong advocate through different institutions, mainly to the Chamber of Commerce, actively participating in working with governments in terms of how we can help in this digital agenda. We also think that it's not all about digital. This also is the interaction between digital and physical, and we, as a retailer, we know that very well. And as Walmart, we get to interact in that world. We know that the future is a blend. It's not just one way or the other. And we have a lot of experience there, how we're building that future in terms of, we call it omni-channel. That we can also share, because it will be exactly the same with citizens in the future. And also we think that there's two big areas where we are mainly focused as a business now, and this is coming from our experience. One is, and that impacts in this case our business around the world, and one is license and permits. License and permits is a key issue nowadays in business, because it's getting tougher and tougher. There's more regulations coming in, and et cetera. And there is a big room there for improvement and using digital technology with several objectives. Number one would be anti-corruption. This is the number one or one of the biggest source of corruption in many markets. Around the world, and we think that transparency in terms of rules, in terms of payments, in terms of mitigations can have a big impact. Also in terms of inclusion, we have I'm responsible for many markets where informality is still a huge part of the economy. And part of that informality is because those people, they don't have access to formal retail. And a lot of that lack of access is because of license and permits, and it's because of the difficulties and the regulations that for company like us to expand, and lastly, because of competitiveness, we know that it's a key aspect. We all talk about growth. We're seeing this growth slowing down, and we see that usually the usual subject of all the regulations and all the focus are the established, well compliance companies, and that of course it's not helping with growth. So that's one area of, and the other area that we are also very much focused as a priority is digital payments. We have good experience around the world of how this is changing and why it's so important, because this is access. This is having hundreds of millions of people having access to financial service to transact at a low cost. Because today they basically are a big percentage of the population is just confined to cash, and also cash connects a lot with informality in many of these markets. And we're seeing interesting experience. We have a big business in India, and we participate there with PhonePay, the company. India set up an infrastructure that is allowing those transactions, and it's very interesting what is happening there. I was talking just today in a meeting with the Minister of Finance from Mexico, and they're trying to do something similar with CODI. And we're looking, that can be very transformational project and focus for governments in terms of how they make life easier and they change the life of many, many people. And having access and also at a lower cost.
Thank you. Jocelyn, you have an exciting AI startup, Telepathy Labs. What are you working on? Where do you see some promise with what's happening in governments and how AI can be a useful driver for government transformation?
Thanks, Corey. So we have, I have an exciting red carpet project that I am really excited about, and we didn't create it. It was created by a bunch of collaborations between government and universities. And it involves handling opioid addiction at the state level, which is a major cost and problem for every state, if not every country in this world. And a solution has been proposed and is we are tech enabling with AI to provide online counseling for opioid addicts. You can imagine the complexity of that because you're looking at live recommendations from an AI, monitoring patients, assisting therapists, helping lots of people that come and go that have lots of different problems with a common symptom of an addiction. What I love about the project is there's a lot of interesting ethical topics in the AI arena regarding sentiment analysis, emotion detection, intent analysis, and you would think that you just legally never get a product through. And yet, states have found a way to do it. There are three states, New York being one of them, that is starting a program, and we are the digital technology in the back of that that is going to enable online counseling, which is going live this fall. And we're very excited and proud to be a part of that project. We have other projects. We're working with smart police officers in cities. And I would say most of the initiatives that we got involved with started with some sort of a public servant or public group that was able to define a problem. And when they were able to clearly define a problem, then it's easy for me as an AI person to come in and bring a solution. And so I see the collaboration at the local government level and the state government level to define micro problems, because to me the work ahead of us is it's day one of AI. There's infinite problems. And it's up to governments to decide where are we going to start. And part of that is where do people need government the most? And that's why I love this one project. I think it's a very exciting and very new innovative solution to a horrifying problem.
Thank you. Accenture is one of the biggest contractors working with the US government. Kathy, you lead the federal digital gov work. What are some of the agencies you're working with? What are some of the exciting projects you have going on, at least the ones you can talk about?
So you can imagine we can't talk about many of them. Sure you all understand that. So we're really working across government in response to a trend that I see that I find super exciting that builds on the work that we did in the previous administration. And that's that all across government, both on the civilian and the defense side, there's a recognition that if we don't start designing government programs, projects, and systems, and even policies around the people who need them, we will continue to not solve some of the most kind of long-lasting issues that sit before government. And so we're seeing the shift, and just as evidence of that, since we opened a digital design studio 3 years ago, we've done now over 150 projects across all of government. So it's not just a pocket of forward-leaning agencies, but I think government-wide, there's a recognition that if you're going to truly leverage new technologies and digital platforms like AI, like machine learning, like natural language processing, you can't just throw technology or even smart people from inside or outside government, but you have to start with really understanding what the problems are and how they affect and bring in the people, the stakeholders, as part of that, using human-centered design and service design to go from the inside out, or excuse me, go from the outside in, and build around those people and their needs rather than starting with technology, government organization, or policy or regulation.
Thanks. Any one project come to mind that you feel like embodies that model?
Yeah, I think one that's been widely publicized and that is really starting to have real impact is what USDA is doing around farmers. So farmers get lots and lots of services from USDA, including loans, insurance, technical assistance. And in the past, there were multiple USDA agencies that offered different services, but that served the same customer. And rather than having that farmer, that rancher, that producer enter data multiple times into multiple systems and continually have to repeat their story, USDA is launching a new portal called farmers.gov that brings a single front door to farmers, ranchers, and producers, and more importantly, allows for the data to be leveraged across all of those services, because it's not just about making data available, it's making it useful so that government can provide the services that those customers and those citizens need.
Great, thank you so much. Sounds a lot like what you're doing in Tel Aviv as well.
Yeah.
All right, Mark, let's turn to you. So you also have an exciting AI software company. You develop products that governments can use. So tell us a little bit about that. And I know you also are really passionate about kind of training and supporting the pipeline of technologists working on all the things. So what's working well in both of those examples?
Thanks, Corey. Great question. Indeed, I think in whatever sector you are, be it government or private sector or nonprofit sector, if you're working with technology, the most important thing that comes to my mind is always being rated to how fast the technological progress really is. Because people tend to underestimate it in every sector. I've been in the government myself, so I know how people think, and this is usually quite slow, probably, in any government. With Zimin Foundation, we target the teams that develop want to develop breakthrough technology, are currently in the research phase, but clearly focused at creating a technology with real world impact, and we're trying to speed it up. With Tiger, we have already developed AI solutions to automate and speed up information processing, information extraction. We do that. So what is the most important thing I see? It is probably that there are a lot of technologies in every segment that can bring disruption to the way how you operate. So for instance, if you are a government and you focus on incremental improvement of the process, yes, you might get it better, 10% better, then again 10% better. But at the same time, you risk losing an opportunity to disrupt it and make it 100% better just in 1 year. Examples of technologies and projects that allow doing that are everywhere. For instance, again, with Zimin Foundation, we do a lot of things in Israel, and there are projects, for instance, healthcare. There are teams that, instead of optimizing traditional surgeries, heart surgeries, have come up with a few ways to create 3D printed cardiac patches or even hearts using human tissues, and then you completely change the way how you do the surgeries, and for instance, you can do all the things needed within one surgery instead of three, which is a huge disruption. With Tiger, Singapore government is our client, several agencies, and again, for instance, the search engine which we provide, which is quite unusual, allows search for the information within government agencies much faster, much faster. And the same refers to all other big organizations. So I think the conclusion that I see, and it's probably the most important thing. Usually life is about opportunities that just fly around. And in technology world, some of these opportunities are disruptive, and some are just incremental. So in order to do disruption, including government technology disruption, you just need to be open to finding that disruption opportunity. If you are open, you will catch it.
Easy as can be. All right. So, David, I saved you for last in this round because your work at Harvard has really been tracking all of these digital government efforts around the world. You bring digital gov leaders together every summer at Harvard to learn from one another and share practices, overcome challenges. So from your vantage point, where you've been really studying and writing and thinking a lot about this, what are you seeing from the big picture perspective that's working well? Where should we be spending our time and energy and you know, cutting tape and rolling out carpets and catching the things that land? And you know, what are those really meaningful, impactful, high-value efforts?
So there's maybe like two historical stories that I want to kind of share to put light on the things that I think matter. So the first is literally tomorrow I'll be teaching, and one of the things I show to my students is the famous map from London of the cholera outbreak and how they tracked mortality rates. And then we're able to pinpack which exact wells were the ones that were the source of cholera and shut those down and then help the city. And you know, my big fear that is at the moment right now, most of the digital work is kind of like the technologists look like magicians because they can find the wells and close them and save a whole bunch of lives. And people are really, really happy about that. But the true transformation was actually the construction of the sewer system and a water system and like the deep core infrastructure that allowed London to stop shrinking and start growing again. And what I'm concerned about is I don't feel like a lot of people are actually talking about the bigger conversation of what is the core infrastructure of a 21st state look like. And instead, we're kind of spending most of our time kind of fighting fires and getting what I think are relatively important but incremental gains and not the really significant gains that we're going to need to have to power states in the future. The second kind of historical arc that I want to kind of shine on is the fact that when you look inside most enterprise, but especially government, it's not like technology is new. We've been doing technology for 60, 70 years in most governments. It's just a lot of the systems that we've been relying on have been kind of back-end systems. And the reason why technology is suddenly a really exciting thing to talk about in government is that these technologies are now actually public servant facing, and more importantly, they're citizen facing. So I used to joke that like nobody ever got fired for an implementation that went wrong, and that was probably true 30 years ago. But now as they become more and more visible to citizens, people are getting fired. And so suddenly that's making everything a little bit more kind of like on everybody's radar, something they need to be thinking about and paying attention to. So I'm most excited about the huge opportunity of kind of thinking about what is the core infrastructure, we can call them platforms, whatever, what is that core infrastructure that we're gonna need? And then I think the second thing that excites me is, what are we going to do to train people to understand that? Because I'm actually not persuaded by the interventionist model. I actually don't think we're going to solve this by having a few people come in for a year or two coming out of the private sector. What we're really going to have to do is figure out how are we going to train an entire cohort of future public leaders to understand this, and then train the technologists to work with them more effectively, and then what is the kind of robust, scalable, and sustainable model of having them work together? Figuring that out is a challenge that I find really exciting.
Wonderful, thanks. So I think that is a fantastic way to move us into more of a dialogue. We're here around this table. We have a lot of great sets of expertise to draw on. We've learned a little bit about what has moved a lot of us to do this work. So let's turn to a few different topics. And so we'll spend the remainder of our time diving into these various topics that I will lob out to the group and then slowly back away from, perhaps. So first, we hear a lot about emerging technology. We have two AI companies at the table. As the governor mentioned, the robots are coming for our jobs. So with all of this exciting opportunity space with robotics and automated vehicles, AI, machine learning, blockchain, all of the things, would you talk a little bit about the need to balance experimentation with these new technologies with just delivering the basic services of government? Something we've all experienced can still be a challenge for our governments. How do we balance both of those needs and desires?
So can I speak to delivering the basic services of government? My sense, by the way, for what it's worth, is that government is not doing as much as the private sector is in this area, with the possible exception of the black world, the so-called classified world that Kathy does a lot of work in, and that's much of the Defense Department, a little bit of Justice, a little bit of state, a little bit of Homeland Security. But I remember from my days in state government that we were very well aware of our failures. We were trying to get the adoption rate up. It just wouldn't happen. We couldn't figure out why. We didn't think that services were being delivered to the mentally ill in a way that was really floating the boat. Same for the developmentally disabled. These are knotty problems. Social service delivery of services is among the knottiest issues in state government. I'm a guy who knows a lot about government, knows very little about technology. I'm a lay observer here. But I just want to suggest that the focus on services is well placed. And, you know, as Hila said, technology is a tool. And I think if you bring people who know a lot about government and who are not training to go into government, I mean frustrated people who have been in government and know the failures of government, they'll be able to do a statement of the problem for what the hell is wrong and where government has fallen down on the job. And if you can have a definition of the problem, then the famous tool can be deployed to attack that problem. And I leave it to you experts how, for example, in my case of the 10 or 15 million workers who don't have the technical skills they need to get the replacement jobs that'll keep them in the workforce, they're all different. I mean, this is probably a job for AI as opposed to somebody with an Excel spreadsheet. And they have different capabilities, and there are, you know, 15 million jobs out there that are going to be created. And to do the mix and match there is probably beyond the capability of a bureaucracy, but it wouldn't be beyond the capability of AI as we go forward. So I'm contending for bringing in veteran, you know, idealistic, but veteran government people to help define the problem at the outset.
I think new technology is always a risk, and you should have a well-calculated approach to take this risk. It's a bit similar to investment. If you invest, you want to preserve the body, but you want to grow the interest, and how much you want to grow depends on your risk appetite. The same in the government, that providing basic service is a mandatory thing, and you should not risk the quality of the service provision by any experiment. But on top of that, probably the right strategy is to constantly experiment, and that's why in many governments you see a lot of proofs of concepts going on at the same time. You do not risk the basic service provision, but you separately try to figure out what works well, and when it is confirmed, you implement it. It happens all the time, for instance, in our AI space working with information. Oh, just over the last 5-7 years, a huge area called robotic process automation has emerged. And it was not there 10 years ago. It's about automating repetitive tasks when you create software robot scripts that do this screen scraping and the related things instead of a human. 10 years ago, it was not there. After that, it got confirmed. And whew, in 3 years, it's implemented everywhere, and the disruption comes.
Yeah, this is not about a government, but governments. Many years ago, I was a trade minister, and I was involved in negotiation of a customs union in East Africa. And we found that you could agree a lot about tariffs and what to do about them, but you could not understand that the biggest challenge was non-tariff barriers to trade. And the biggest barrier to international trade among emerging, integrating countries is a barrier called feigned ignorance. A customs officer says, I don't know whether you're supposed to get this in without paying duty. But just, it can be pretense, it can be true. And this led me to be very happy that when African countries signed up a continental free trade area in July in Niamey, the gift we gave them is a smartphone-based real-time solution to non-tariff barriers, that any driver is told you are not allowed this and can instantly on his phone find out whether it is true that he's not allowed to move across the border with this. And there is instant registration at the center of the customs body in Accra and in the capitals of the countries concerned that there is this barrier being applied to a driver. And in a way, I find it phenomenally important in just easing the movement of goods, particularly in countries that just are entering a new common market. But one of the things that really excites me, we've been doing, we run a program called the Automated System for Customs Management, which is now the standard wear for customs management in 103 countries in the world, which has been not only phenomenal in simplifying, but also building integrity in customs management, but also the backbone for single window as a step towards e-government. Yeah.
Just jump right in.
I'm jumping. No, I think the reason why people like me exist, I think, is because governments must also realize that innovation has to be part of their core business. I think in Africa, for example, I don't think we have a choice. Our median age is 19.1. So basically, it's a population that is is basically a digital population. So how can you not be experimenting in terms of understanding how they are? Of course, an average age of a public servant is what, 50? So definitely there are challenges there. And my sense at the moment, and I agree with the people who are talking about capacity, especially around executive education for sort of the cohort around the leadership, is that they have to understand that if you're dealing with the population, then you have to be responsive. And the responsive bit of it means you have to talk to young people, and young people engage through technology innovation. So I think for me, we should not be afraid. And I think we have to remove that element of fear. And in our government, I mean, the president is leading from the front. He's saying, listen, I am a digital president. So do, right? So if you don't do, then I think is a lot of self-censorship from our case. I think the other bit that I'm excited about that is the peer learning culture that is emerging. And so that because you know Argentina is doing it, because you know the US is doing it, so how do you learn and innovate as you do, but simply contextualize it to your own region? So I think for me, the message is, listen, you have to do it. The second thing, I think you have to co-create. The third thing, you have to collaborate. We thrive in multi-stakeholder ecosystems. There's no more vendor-client relationship with governments. It's about how do you leverage around private sector capabilities and bring that into the culture of governments.
So I want to take from that point, I think we take ourselves a little bit too much seriously as government, and I think we should put more focus on the private sector. There's a lot we can learn from the private sector that is running much faster than us. Most of the people here around the table are from the public sector in this or that way, but actually the solutions come from the private sector, and it's okay to use my term from before and put the red carpet for them. All we need to do is open our door, understand what our residents need, whether it's in cities, in government, whatever, and help that private sector give us the solutions that are already there. For us in Tel Aviv, we learn now from Africa about financial tools, okay, because we're all afraid to open our financial systems. But in Africa, you're doing it, and you're brilliant about it. So we can learn from each other, but mostly open to the private sector. I think if the government very, very largely cities or any other, will allow the private sector, look at Waze, look at WhatsApp, look, like if we would wait for those things, they give us such great solutions to whatever we need. And we all, in government, we use WhatsApp. It's private. In government, we use all these tools. So, and remember, it's only tools. So taking those things, I think, can make it easier for us.
I'd love to pick up on that, and also I won't take it so seriously. I think one of the things too, and it comes back to like, what's a good analogy for platforms? Because I talk to people about this a lot, and prior to digital health, I worked for commercial software, building new software platforms for about a decade. And the analogy we used to use was actually Disney World. And so a really good platform at its core is exactly like your experience at Disney World. You go in and it's seamless. It's just pure fun. Everything has been taken care of for you. You have paid, you have been identified, we know who you are, all trash is removed. You don't see the infrastructure. I agree with you very much that we need the infrastructure, but it's a really good set of platforms is that. The reason we did that work was to help try and identify or help government sort of be able to parse through, like, exactly to your point, you do need the private sector engaged in this, and these platforms exist, whether that's ID or messaging or data analytics or, you know, 16 other pieces. And if you actually put together sort of a thoughtful plan for how you want to serve your citizens, A, B, identify which infrastructure you want to invest in first, because it's never built overnight. And then C, you're then taking sort of a thoughtful approach to rolling that out. You can actually put in place the standards and guidelines that lets all the magical things get built on top of it. Because that is how scale in the private sector and tech has worked, not because the government went and did it all themselves.
So just building on many of the things people are saying in this idea of peer learning, one of the things we thought about in government was the topics we're talking about, so tech people in a policy conversation together with lawyers, and this very cross-functional team, since the problems of our time are very challenging and need all of us and the different perspectives. And then, of course, digital services, as you're talking about. But it was a third area that we worked a lot on, which I used to nickname Innovation Nation, Innovation World. And it's really using digital technologies to scout and scale for who already fixed the thing, and have them in peer learning. And I'll give you an example for the UN this year. We're on our fifth year of something called the United Nations Solutions Summit. And we started 1 hour after ratification. And it was building on something the UN non-government liaison service was doing, which was reaching out to people to figure out who should join. Who wants to come speak at the UN? And they would open crowdsource, and not only the person's names, but also the selection committee. And the selection committee would choose, and we would have someone join us, and it was collective genius. So we actually asked, who's already fixing the SDGs? And the first year, we got about 800 submissions from 100-something countries. This year, we got 1,400-plus submissions from 141 countries in 3 weeks. And some of that was selection committee members who were for the under 30 group, selected that group, and the over 30. And we have 10 innovators taking the stage this week, pitching during the SDG Media Zone Solutions Hour, which was 11 to 12. And the genius stuff that people are already doing, you can't make it up. And so how do you help us think like the venture capitalists are doing? They don't make the companies. They just go and find genius teams and help them. How do we do that as governments and get into that position, leverage our digital collaboration capabilities in that way? And one of the ones that you were making me think about is the satellites. So right now, we all talk all day about how are we going to get the kids into STEM. Well, they're super bored by the way that we're teaching them. It's really boring. But the way that we teach children to read and write is very important, right? We learn how to do this, we learn to write, but we don't teach children to express themselves in STEM. They have to absorb all these facts, but they don't get to discover, invent, create, design as part of kindergarten. First grade, second grade, all the way up, apprentice journey mastery. So if you take the satellite imagery that you guys have, and then you give every child a login to these small sats, which we have now, and this is possible, and there's companies already doing this with schools, then when you're doing your earth science work, you actually could be working on your hometown for your homework. And it would be way more interesting to be doing STEM as opposed to sort of something someone else wants to work on. Sensors and robotics and all these different things. We have such cheap technologies. We have these great sensors for our environment. So one of my hopes is as our youth are doing so much leadership in the climate marches, that they also step into action and start radically sharing with each other about all the things people of all ages are already doing and how they can step into solutions as part of their schooling. Los Angeles is already doing this with the Data Science Federation. They have city teams posting problems that they need help with. And then the students, as their homework for capstone projects, it's a couple week projects, just pick a city team, help them build out the tools. They post it on GitHub. They post their screenshots. And then it's really great because when they want to go to the government contractor, they have a prototype to say, we'd like something like this that we did with the students. And the students come to Civic Tech. So sometimes the problems are actually the big problems, you can make them solutions for each other, which is what this move is. And shift 7 in our mind is shift to 7 billion colleagues. What would you like to fix today? How would you like to be? And this is a huge opportunity to get everyone onto the design seat of what they would like to do and activate our citizenry with our government as a platform for them.
So building on that, I think one of the things that we see a real need for is reframing the problems that we're trying to solve, because so often, and I'm sure this is true for others around the table, we're brought in to solve what the government thinks is the problem. And as we start to peel the onion back, we find that it's actually quite a different problem. And so getting sort of focus on what are the outcomes you're trying to accomplish and how you define that problem so that you can accurately identify who are all the stakeholders who both may have available solutions, but also may have a perspective on the problem that would help you more fully be able to solve it. So I think focusing on outcomes and problems and not being so sure that we're always confident that we know what's wrong, but being open to reframing that based on the input from a more diverse group of stakeholders will help us take better advantage not only of the people, but also of the technologies that can be applied.
So maybe, I don't want to sound like a downer, but I have some concerns about government being too on the edge. So I wrote a piece a while ago about how I want my government to be a fast follower. And kind of the way I kind of design it is I kind of don't want my government on the wrong side of the Gartner hype curve. So six years ago, if we'd had a conversation, everyone like, we need to be doing blockchain projects, you know, everywhere in government. And now you kind of look around, and my hope is that no one's doing a blockchain government inside their government right now, or at least you only have one or two to maybe be learning. And so because I think we'd be chasing the wrong thing. And so for me, when I think of kind of the work the digital services groups are doing, often it's actually about bringing practices that are about 10 years old into government. So you think about something like Agile, that's about 10 years old, design thinking, 10 to 20 years old. A lot of these practices actually have been de-risked by the private sector. And then there's a huge amount of innovative work that still needs to take place in order to figure out how to import them into the public sector. That's a huge problem in its own right. And so figuring out how to do that right for me strikes me as the right thing. But what gets me like sleepless is, does that then, like, while I believe that, then I get worried about, do we miss the boat on something like tax forms, and then you allow something like a company like Intuit and TurboTax to exist. And they're like, we didn't move fast enough. And now there's a company that gets to essentially charge a tax on every single American to fill out their tax forms. And that's and it absolves us the responsibility of having to do a better job. And so I'd like to be a fast follower, but I worry that maybe I do understand the risks of moving too slow in how quickly we try to catch up.
So, you know what we can add to that project? Blockchain. That's a question I get asked like 2 times a week. For us, you know, I'm going to take some things, you know, Kathy and Amiga was telling is, you know, you bring skills to government, because the great challenge for us working in this position temporarily is how this can be sustained in time. So, because I'm leaving in December after 4 years. So for us, it's trying to get all our team inside government, all our civil servants, as much as we can, as you know, get down in our technology, in our procedures, so anyone can follow. So I used to say that doing technology in government is past, present, future. I'm building on what someone built, and someone's going to build on what I live in. So all our strategies should be so much clear that anyone can follow, say, OK, that's the path. You know, that's the North Star. And we've been talking for years about government as a platform. And the real platform is the citizen. It's not government. And that's what scares politicians about digital transformation, because that transition between being the authority and become, you know, a service provider and making politicians irrelevant of the service they're giving to the citizens, that's a common idea in the third world, in the developing countries. It's, you know, that's the limitation about, that's the red tape about transforming government, you know, being not losing relevance. So that's the challenge about transcending.
I'm going to shift us to one more topic with the group and then leave some time for questions with the audience. We got started a few minutes late, so we might run a few minutes past 5:30. So let's shift to talking about data. Data drives, or should drive, a lot of the decisions that we make in government. Government collects massive amounts of data, releases much of it as open data. And we're at this time where we're really facing an inflection point, whether you're in the public or private sectors, about the data we collect and maintain, what we do with it, how we keep that secure, how we protect privacy, how we give consumers rights around their data. So talk a little bit about some of those issues. How can government be better leveraging data to optimize performance? And what are some good strategies we know of, or what are some challenges we're experiencing around data protection and our use of and governance and management of data? We'll spend a few minutes on that, then we'll shift to Q&A and wrap it up.
Okay. While people are thinking about this.
Don't all jump at once.
First of all, the exponential growth of data as the driver of the digital economy is not run by government. The statistic I was sharing from the Digital Economy Report, in the year 2000, the global measure of data movement is the Internet Protocol of data is IPT. It was like 200 gigabytes per second. The year 2000, 2018, it was 140,000 gigabytes per second. Much of this is run off platforms that have nothing to do with governments. And we're in the situation where data, now government have access to data more than any other time before. But it's a challenge of how much capacity do they have to convert raw data into digital information. I mean, of course, the miracle of the digital market is monetizing data. And that's part of the debate on the development side. How much can regulators have the capacity to regulate what they cannot control? And the first phase of the digital revolution has been this libertarian notion of less government is better government, until it started falling into problems of cross-border integrity of electronic commerce, the right to taxation, and the right to privacy, who is the interlocutor for privacy and competition. This is the development nexus that has not sufficiently grown. And I think it's part of what has driven the desire to start having fast-tracking e-commerce negotiations at WTO. But as that's where we are, there's a phenomenal capacity. I mean, just a bit of it has been mentioned here. The use of big data for projecting crop season weather, and therefore advising insurance companies on what kind of margins for premiums. Is an example, the use of big data in rapid response to epidemics, which is happening in many developing countries. But the big data being generated raw and converted into monetized value for advertisement. We just see it when we are seeing the shrinking traditional advertisement. We have a good example in the US. Newspaper advertisement was worth $200 billion in 2000. It was down to $24 billion last year. And it's projected to be down to $4 billion in 3 years, just because of the massive rise of online advertisement as the vehicle. But just some ideas on this. Yeah.
I could speak a little bit about being a small company. There's a lot of very big companies and governments, but doing business internationally, serving large global companies, private companies, have very complex issues regarding the big data that they're collecting, and then combining that with personal privacy, the financial information of the customers, the ethics standards of what people are allowing you to track about them, consumer goods that you're buying, travel that you're doing, and your participation in a global economy is actually, you're more identifiable by private enterprise through your participation in a global economy than you are by your government. And it's interesting, but like a travel, if you study people's movement in airlines or hotels or just in travel in general, they have more information about a person and their buying behavior, their travel patterns, where they're located, how they spend their time. Which actually is just much more personal than even your government identity number. And if you wanted to, I thought there was an interesting use case. I had a city, and they're interested in disaster prevention. They're interested in what happens if there's an attack in the city. It's a, you know, there's many small cities incorporated separately. They don't federate. They don't unite their data right now. It's, you know, one city manages their fire and police and another city manages theirs, but they're in the same metropolitan area. So they have all these problems around, like, what would you do if there was an emergency? Well, ironically, the tourist applications have the answers. They have all of the travel information, the buses, the subways. They have airport information. They're tracking people when they arrive. They're getting people's identities that are opting in. And actually, if you wanted to prevent a disaster, the fastest way to do it would be on a travel platform. And probably the least reachable solution will be through a government. So I find that very interesting. You're looking at large data aggregations. And actually, if private companies unite their data even further, you would end up with something like Google. And Google actually can do a better job of finding out what's happening with the weather, what's happening, how many flights are taking off from LaGuardia in the next 10 minutes. They can figure out better what restaurants you can go to, what movies you can go to, where people are, what buses are taking off. It goes on and on and on, and you have one big platform that is actually a better disaster prevention platform than any government platform that's ever going to get created, because none of the governments are going to federate all that data. It's very interesting. And the other thing I would just, I'm just throwing out kind of topics rather than solutions, but as a vendor, we can get hired by anybody. There's, you know, any private company that says, hey, Jocelyn, we want to hire you to track these people. I can do that internationally. They can hire me to track all of their consumers worldwide. And we can buy information from Google and we can combine it. And you can get vast amounts of very interesting data about the population, and there is no regulating body. In fact, there's no way to for anybody really to know who's tracking what. And it's a very powerful ecosystem. I see a lot of the projects we're working on are really high integrity, honest people trying to solve problems for buyers and consumers, B2B and B2C. But you could also see that, you know, in the wrong hands 10 years from now, that information could be used very differently. And you don't really know where the information's going to end up or who's going to buy who. So for me, government's just kind of missing out on a lot. When you look at big data aggregation, government could certainly, they have the equal right to purchase that data. And I think they are. I don't know everything the government's doing, but on the private side, it's there's a lot of information about what people are up to. There's also comment on the difference between governments, but like when you arrive in Singapore, you know, they facial recognition you upon arrival, and you can't go anywhere in Singapore where they're not monitoring you, and it's a very good government, and they're doing a good job protecting their citizens in a very scalable, efficient way. But it's okay. Very interesting. Sorry.
Wonder if there are other thoughts on how Singapore's doing with that data. Go on.
Just specifically on face recognition, we just had testimony in Congress. We have a challenge that face recognition software is very racist right now, and sexist and ageist. And so it works extremely well for light-skinned males of a certain age, which are the dominant group that has all the programming jobs and doesn't let other people into those jobs through arrogance and other things and systemic racism, sexism, and ageism. And so there's lots of work being going on that, but not enough, and the priorities aren't high enough in the tech companies. This is issue number 20, not issue top 10, so they're not solving it at the way that they certainly could. There's no question. When people focus on it, they solve it. So I think I agree with you. There's governments doing amazing things. Singapore, the garden city, like genius. But this challenge of like setting minimums around data, this all hail algorithm kind of stuff, we have to really watch out for it because the data sets, for example, specifically back to face recognition, and NIST data, our standardized data, 80% of the faces in the standard data that for algorithm testing right now that the US uses in NIST is 80% pale male, certain age, 5% young women of color. So just the data sets are so biased that we're training these algorithms on. And so we really have to get together as a world and think about, did we really mean to do all the medical testing on only men? Did we really mean to, like, there's a lot of bias in our system. And this stuff is fixable. I'll call an example from Kodak. Kodak Kodachrome, historically, the chemistry was mixed for a certain kind of visual, a Shirley card, a very light-skinned woman. And so people of color didn't show up properly in the chemistry as you were developing your film. Fuji did better with different markets and stuff. So just like our camera today, you know, why do we have to turn on the flash for certain people and not others? This is very offensive and oppressive. And so we have to really notice these things as governments and do something about them. I would share the example that Kodak did fix the problem. When the furniture advertisers and the chocolate advertisers complained, not for humans, but they really actually fixed this technology. So it was eminently fixable the whole time, but they didn't bother. So this idea that the tech's ready, it's not ready. There has to be a floor on what we do, and we as governments, certainly in face recognition, need to not allow this technology to be deployed. Certainly, there's a conversation right now. We were talking this morning on lethal autonomous weapons. You know, this is very serious technology that needs to work for all humans, human in the last minute loop, human in the meaningful loop. So lots of these kinds of conversations has to happen. And I think that paying attention to data set comprehensibility and setting floors and rules and regulation around this stuff is really quite urgent. And the best way to do that is by getting really cross-functional. Lots of different teammates trying things and noticing where the problems are and saying no, not yet, on some of these technologies until we're ready.
All right, we have some waving hands in the room. So I'm going to actually suggest we do a few last questions before we have to wrap up. I'm sorry, I know there were plenty of more comments around this table, but we can stick around and chat as well. So this gentleman over here has a burning question, and we want to hear it.
Sorry, so the reason why I've been triggered by this conversation the whole entire time because I'm a Myanmar American running an IT social enterprise in Myanmar, also known as Burma, for the last 7 years, right? So this whole conversation is just like triggering me. I kind of agree with a blend of what everyone's saying. And that, so I'm in the nitty gritty. So we work with USAID, UNFPA, the Myanmar Civilian Government, the Ministry of Health, the Supreme Court, the municipal tax authorities. We're helping them create a much better, cheaper version of TurboTax, to David's point. We have 160 employees, 93% are Myanmar nationals, 60 software developers, 50% are women, trained using MOOCs, which I think David's also looking at. I need to talk with David. And so a lot of this stuff I think development aid, and also I want to say governments in both developing and developed countries have issues that are huge impediments to making progress on this. So I'll give you an example. We worked with NHS Digital, the UK, right? They got hacked, right, by the WannaCry ransomware worm this year because they didn't regularly patch their computers with their standard Microsoft security patch update, right? The former CTO of NHS Digital, I won't name that person, did not know what APIs were, did not know what graph databases were. This is like the CTO of NHS Digital of one of the richest economies in the world, right? If you look at development aid, I think there's a huge issue. You know, we work with like all the UN.
Can we move to that question, please?
Yes. So what I'm trying to say is there are not technologists staffed in development aid, and how, like, that needs to be fixed. People with modern industry 4.0 agile methodology development, we have to fight this the whole entire way. Like, how can that be fixed?
Who's on it? Let's do one more question, and then we'll do some comments. This gentleman here.
David Wilcox, Reach Scale. I'm going to suggest you follow Zia, and you all go to the place where the most investment is being done on this, India. And you go there to get a whole bunch of new questions that we're not asking. Because India did the largest digital citizen system years ago. They've got 1 billion people registered. One question would be, why is there no rush of additional digital services flowing out of that platform? Another question would be, given that India has the most technological capability outside of the two countries doing all the blockchain patents, and they're not waiting to do blockchain because we did the patents, why aren't we seeing a rush of that? When the government decided to innovate, they didn't do anything with blockchain. They gave free bank accounts. And when the people didn't take advantage of the free bank accounts, they did demonetization. And 2 years ago, if you were in India, you would have heard that Modi's going to lose the election because of demonetization. So they were trying to force people to use the technology that they wouldn't use, or couldn't use, or didn't have the systems to use. And so the government tried to force them to use the technology. So I'd go ask those questions in that place where those investments and things are being done to try to understand how could we reallocate our investments. We've spent a ton of money on self-driving cars. Anybody who's driven in India could tell you no self-driving car is going to be in India for 20 years. It's just not going to happen. So that will get you some new questions that would help us think about new ways to allocate the resources to, you know, I don't do AI when I'm in India and I ask for a bribe. I pay the bribe, and then I report it on ipaytobribe.com. No new technology, just put in the report. So, I mean, that's kind of where the rest of the world, and that's where India is, which is way ahead of the rest of the world. So just a place to get some new questions.
Thank you. We're very short on time, so I'll just ask the colleagues around the table to offer any responses, and then we'll wrap up.
I wanted to talk to the challenge about what is needed. I lead an organization which has been doing diagnostic studies in developing countries, the state of play on e-readiness. We have done 27 countries. And the most glaring challenge is political illiteracy about the digital economy. The key policy makers treat with contempt what they don't understand. And therefore, there is no relationship between the GDP per capita of a country and the level of digital infrastructure available. As a commission, I was sharing this yesterday with the Broadband Commission, that Rwanda has less than 1/15 of the GDP per capita of Angola. And Rwanda has more than 15 times as much digital inclusion, broadband inclusion, than Angola. So there is a dislink, a dealing, and the big thing is policy support. Just a polite way of saying political laggards.
And I want to pick up on that, and also the gentleman's question over there. So that framework that I was sharing with you is actually modeled and then compared also with India Stack, which is what he is referencing with the Aadhaar. There are a lot of challenges with India Stack. I am a huge fan, but there are a lot of challenges. So I'm going to just say that, and we're just going to leave that because that would take a very long debate. But I want to come back to your comment, and your point was is that there'd be more questions, and why has this not happened, and why are people not looking at India or Estonia or a lot of the Middle East or a lot of Latin America where this has been done as well? I would just say that a big part of this is the political will. You have to first find, we have never found a country where a digital transformation has not been done, where the president did not commit to it and drive it. Then the regulation flew from there, everything else. And then everybody else was like, now we got to fix it because somebody said it and I really have to now go do it. And so that has been 100% where this has been driven. What we tried to do in this framework was actually try and look at that and say, like, okay, so what are those building blocks? Because for those people who aren't yet there, how are you going to actually encourage policymakers to begin to see it? Because they're hearing about India, and they're hearing about Rwanda, and they're hearing about Estonia, and they're like, hey, we can do this too. And this is what it's going to save us in terms of money, and this is what it's going to save us in terms of cost. But I would say, and then I promise I will stop, is that it does come from the data. So I want to come back to your question, because the most powerful way that we've seen anybody adopt this, and I've talked to governments for decades about this, hey, why don't you do this? And their eyes glaze over, and they're like, I don't want to talk to you about ID systems. It's really boring. They want to see a dashboard. They want to see a dashboard that tells them, where should my supplies go? How many people need to be treated with Ebola? They want real-time information. So we've got to stop talking about data as if it's separate from the digital systems. The data comes from the digital systems. You have to put in place the digital infrastructure, then the data flows from that. Then you need enough qualified people to your point and his point about who can actually use that information for practical purposes to answer real questions. And I think when you bring those efforts together, you then do see true political will. But it's kind of unclear what's the driving force that I've seen outside of political will, but I invite others to comment.
Yes, I think we share the frustration because I think one of the key challenges about regulations, and is this, we're not only the digital economy is being impacted by lack of regulation but also the brick and mortar economy is also being impacted with a lot of regulation, which is not the right one. So I think the key challenge here is how we have maybe less regulation, but better regulation. Second, regarding the India example, which I think is a good example, and there's a lot of huge opportunities here. And because the example that just mentioned about demonetization was not only about adoption, accelerating adoption of the e-wallet or the, the e-banking. It was about informality, addressing. India has a huge issue with informality in the economy. And so they were trying also to, Moody was trying to tackle that with the demonetization. And we know that there is huge opportunities for using the technology, and this is spread issue in at least in the emerging world.
David, last word. Yeah. Just two thoughts. First is on Megan's point. This is why I like my 10-year waiting period, because for exactly the reasons you talk about, the facial recognition software is not where we want it to be, and it has all these problems, and this gives us a chance to then go and evaluate it. But I think the one thing I want to say is, because there's been such an enthusiasm of the private sector, I'm not really sure that the public's so convinced that, as the people on the panel are, about how great the private sector has been in this space, especially in the last 2 years. Even as something as simple as like when Enroll Me was made public, that they were harvesting data to like sell like you know what your trips were and how much you were paying to Lyft, to Uber, pretty much everybody dropped their Enroll Me account overnight. And for me, that suggests that the private sector's entire way of approaching data is unbelievably fragile and could collapse tomorrow at any moment, or could collapse at any moment. And I'm really sure I want to build a government that's modeled after that. Doubly so, given that it doesn't really bother me that you know what's going to happen with my data when it's in Facebook's hand is someone's probably going to try to sell me something. The government can do real harm to me. They can end my life. They can put me in jail. They can take my family away. Like there are things that a government can do that a private sector player has a much harder time doing to me. So if we're going to go and model our governments after that, I'm going to take a lot more caution and say I really want to make sure I can figure out what that looks like. And then the final piece is I'm not really convinced that governments, that the data is going to help our governments as much as we think. Many of the big problems of our time, whether it's the opium crisis or climate change, more data is not going to help us. We know what the problem is. We know a lot of what the answers need to be. Having more data is not going to make that easier. It requires political will to actually go after the problems and solve the problems we already know how to solve. And so my big fear is that the project around having governments get more data is a way of kicking down the can the hard needed work around political mobilization that we need to take to in order to tackle the problems we have. More data is just a way of delaying, not helping us.
All right. Well, we need to end it here. And I think that's a good call to action to take to the streets on these red carpets. Thank you so much for being here. Thank you to the Concordia Summit for having us. We really appreciated the great dialogue with this incredible group. Thanks for traveling far and wide to join us. If you're interested in learning more about our work at Georgetown University at the Beck Center, that's B-E-E-C-K, follow us on social media, sign up for our newsletter, and you can track what we're doing to help support government transformations by leveraging digital services and the incredible people we have working on this effort. So thank you again for being here. Goodbye.